Welcome to this demonstration of the HPE CSI Driver Beta for Red Hat OpenShift. This demo uses OpenShift 4.1, where CSI is currently in technology preview. The HPE CSI Driver is a multi-platform and multi-vendor driver where any interested party may develop a container storage provider, a CSP as we call it. The CSP is a much simpler control plane chip that abstracts away all the intricacies of Kubernetes and all the backend storage data management, such as discovering runs or formatting file systems, which can be a quite daunting task for a developer. In this demo, we're going to deploy the driver to utilize two different HPE Nimble storage arrays, one all-flash and one hybrid flash. We'll then deploy a WordPress app server and a MariaDB database using persistent volumes dynamically provisioned by the CSI driver through an OpenShift Stores class API object. Another capability OpenShift also have available as a feature gate in technology preview is the direct use of block devices. This opens up for applications that crave raw block access and suffers from the double buffering overhead that file systems provide. So let's dive in. The HPE CSI driver for Kubernetes is available on GitHub, and all the instructions are currently available on how to deploy it on Kubernetes, but it also applies to Red Hat OpenShift just as much. So I'm going to spare you all a lot of the details here, but I'm going to do all the steps needed to deploy the driver. So first of all, we need two secrets to point to the two arrays that we have in our environment we're going to deploy to. So I'm going to log into the UI here and create those two secrets. I'm going to copy and paste those in here, and we can see we have an old hybrid flash system here. It's named SJC array 869, and we also have a few other parameters here, like the username and password for that particular array, and also where the container storage provider is listening, and that is basically a service on the cluster. We haven't deployed that yet, but we get to that part. So, and we also need to put another secret for the all flash system. Copy and paste that in here. And that, as you can see, points to a completely different backend. And these two arrays are in two discrete groups. They're not connected in a HPE Nimble storage array group. They're both independent. All right, so we can see here we got our secrets here. Perfect. So now I need to log in from the CLI, because we need to copy and paste a few YAML declarations to get our get the CSP installed, and then get all the necessary sidecars needed to be able to provision storage and manage attachment and detachments and such. So let's copy and paste the CSP first. The CSP has a service and a deployment, and then we have the stack of CSI sidecars and also our node driver and controller. So we're just going to wait for those to come up here. We'll wait on that. Yeah, we can see a bunch of services coming up here. So looking at the nodes in my OpenShift cluster here, I have three workers. And we also have a CRD that gives us more information about the workers themselves, and we utilize the CRD to be able to abstract information about the node, such as IQNs and what networks it's connected to. If that would be a fiber channel host, you would be able to see the worldwide port names and so forth. So, and back in the OpenShift UI here, we're going to go and declare storage classes. The provisioner that we have installed does not list the CSI provisioner here, so we need to create a YAML manually. And I'm just going to copy and paste those in here in the edit YAML box here. And here we can see all the different details. Like, we want to create, first of all, create a default storage class. We call that HPE standard. It's going to point to the hybrid flash system. And we also reference the namespace where we deploy the secret, right? So everything is deployed in kube system, and is only You can only manipulate these resources if you are a admin on the system. You can also specify what type of file system you want here. We kind of fall back to XFS because we know it works really well, but we also support ext4 and ButterFS and ext3 as well. And then we have a bunch of provisioner-specific, it's not provisioner-specific, it's actually container storage provider-specific. So these parameters are specific to the HPE Nimble Storage CSP. And we're going to talk a little bit about the storage parameters and storage class parameters a little bit later. So let's just create this storage class, and this is our default one. And then we're going to create another one, edit the YAML there as well. And as you can see here, we're going to call this HPE database. As I mentioned, we're going to deploy a MariaDB database. So this storage class will then be put on the all-flash system, and it has a bunch of different parameters also backend specific here that allows us to tweak and tune that specific volume when it gets created. Let's create that one. We can see we have two storage classes here. So out on the GitHub page here, you can see and observe some examples on how to use the driver, right? So there's the using .md file that will go through some very basic examples on how to get the secrets in place, the creating storage classes, a lot of simple examples, right? And what we're going to show here is the HPE storage class, the storage class parameters. And what we've done here is basically we divided this section into different, the common parameters, the cloning parameters, provisioning parameters, and also the import parameters. Right, so let's get back to OpenShift and deploy our workload. So I'm just going to log out from the OpenShift UI here and log in with my user. So I'm a restricted. So this is the restricted account. Basically, it's just authenticated to the cluster, and I will now be able to create persistent volume claims against the storage classes I created. So the first volume I'm going to create is just going to be a generic volume for the WordPress instance, right? So I'm just going to use the UI elements to create that particular volume. I give it a name, and I give it a size. And you will then be able to create that and immediately see that the volume gets bound and created. There we go. And the other volume, I'm going to actually edit the YAML box here and show you a few of the capabilities here. So we want to be able to tweak the actual volume we create for the MariaDB database. And I'm going to give it a custom description. I want to give it a more snapshots and retain more snapshots for longer. So I've changed the protection template. I'm also very particular who the file system owner is going to be once the container starts up, because I want it to run as a particular UID. And I'm also going to boost the IOPS. The default IOPS on this storage class was 20,000, but I want to give this volume 50,000 IOPS. And I give it a size, and then you will then be able to create this volume. We also need to call out the particular storage class name that we want this persistent volume claim to create a volume against, right? So we call out the HPE-database, and that is the storage class name for the database-specific storage class. Right, it's bound. I'm not going to log into the CLI as my user to just deploy my my database instance and my WordPress instance. These are not any like rocket scientists type deployments. It uses the stock upstream Bitnami images. And we can log into the database here, for instance, and just check the inside the container, inside a pod, that we have a multipath device mapped to whatever host this application is running on. It's the requested size, 4 gig, and it's been mounted on /bitnami, and that's where the MariaDB image from Bitnami actually stores their data. Same thing with the WordPress here. You just do a df. You can see that the multipath device here of 20 gigs is also mounted on /bitnami. All right, so I'm going to go out and I have a route set up for this application. I'm just going to refresh this, and this is essentially what you will land on when you deploy this image for the first time. Log in here with user, username user, password bitnami. And then I'm just going to create some content here. This is awesome. I'm going to upload an image. The most prettiest storage array in the industry. This is the stuff. Publish. And now we have a post in our WordPress instance with an asset, right? So, and just to prove that this is an actual persistent application, I'm going to delete the MariaDB pod. Refresh the site, and you can see that you have a you will have a database outage, and shortly thereafter it's up and running again, and you will be able to refresh the web page and you should get your content back. So back to the UI here, I'm just going to show you another capability here that we also have enabled, and that is basically the capability of creating raw block volumes. So you basically just change the volume mode to block. The default volume mode is always set to file system, but you don't really use that because that is the normal mode of operation. So you set the volume mode to block, create that persistent volume claim, bound instantly with a tiny volume, no formatting involved, and then I'm just going to create a very simple pod, which I just constructed here. It's a utility called IOPing, which essentially checks for storage connectivity either in a file system or a block device. So I'm going to run inside this container, I'm going to run the IOPing command against the block device. And what is different here is that you have the volume devices stanza in your spec here, that points to a device path where you want it mounted, and but then from the, in the volume section here, it's exactly the same. It's just you point to a claim name of a certain name. Right, we're gonna wait for the app to come up here. There we go, and now you can see that we are actually accessing a block device of 32 gig that we created, and that just worked. So back to the CSI driver GitHub page here. This is just a beta. We are currently working diligently to have this available in a general availability state. The version that will ship will also include all the latest capabilities that is available in the CSI spec. That will include volume snapshots that you can create from volume snapshot classes, and you will also be able to specify in your persistent volume claims which data source you want to create the persistent volume claim, and that could be from an existing persistent volume claim that you already have created, or it could be a volume snapshot that you have taken at any point in time. We will also be able to demonstrate the capability of doing online resize of volumes of any of the supported file systems that we support, and bring a lot of more new cool features and capabilities that will become available through the CSI initiative. So until then, take care. That's all for now. Bye.